Hi guys, my name is Avneet and I'm so excited to be your Wise Prof for your first year chemistry course online. This course is actually going to have everything you could need for first year chemistry. You'll see that it has lesson videos where I'll be walking you through different concepts, and I'm gonna stop along the way to give you guys tips, tricks, things that you should memorize, and what is the important thing to take away from a particular note. So you guys are really going to save a lot of time using this course. With that, I'll let you guys get started and see how awesome this chemistry course is for yourself. Let's make chemistry easier together, and let's study smarter, not harder.
First, we should understand just generally what kind of problems we'll be doing and what kind of steps we'll be following. So typically, we'll be first figuring out the number of moles of a reagent. So that's a reactant. Okay, and then we'll be using that and the balanced chemical equation, the stoichiometric coefficient in that balanced chemical equation, to figure out then the moles of a product. And then once we have the moles of a product, we can figure out whatever quantity we're interested in, like the mass or pressure of the product. But the key here is that the moles are the central unit. Here are some equations that I put together for you guys that summarize all the key equations we need for stoichiometry. So the nice thing is two of these equations we've already seen before and we're very familiar with by now. So the first one is N is equal to little m over big M, or MW, molecular weight. So we've seen this one before where you can have moles, you have your mass in grams, and your molar mass in grams per mole. So here, you might be able to solve for the moles of a product and then rearrange using this equation to solve for the mass of a product. The other equation that we've seen before is this one, where it goes N is equal to big N over NA, where your big N represents the number of atoms or molecules, and your NA is Avogadro's constant. Now, this one would be helpful if you're asked to solve for the molecules, or how many molecules there are of a product. So you'd first have to solve for moles, and then you can use this equation to solve for the molecules of that product. There are two other equations I wanted to introduce to you guys now, so we'll see these in problems and they'll come in handy. The first one is N is equal to C times V, where N is still moles, but C is your concentration in moles per liter, and V is volume in liters. Now, it makes sense that V is volume in liters because if you take moles per liter multiplied by liters, the liters will cancel out and you'll be left with moles. One other thing I wanted to point out here is that sometimes you might see the units big M. So, for example, 1.3 big M. That is another way of writing moles per liter. So just keep in mind that when you see either of those, it means they're talking about a concentration. The last equation that we might see is this one, and it comes from the ideal gas law, which is PV is equal to nRT. So if I take that ideal gas law, which you'll see a lot more when you learn about gases, for now we're just focusing on this equation. You might see some problems related to it. You can actually rearrange the solve for moles. So that's all that was done here. And once you have the moles of a product, you could rearrange to solve for maybe pressure if that's what they're asking you for. So if they want you to solve for pressure of a product, for example, you would use this equation, but you would need to solve for moles of that product first. So in this equation, N is still equal to moles. Pressure is going to be in units kilopascals. Volume is still going to be in liters. R is just a constant and it should be memorized. It's 8.314. You don't have to really worry about memorizing those units, but definitely make sure you memorize that number. And then T is your temperature, and it has to be entered in Kelvin if we come across a problem like that. The last little equation that may come in handy is the equation for density. So density is equal to mass over volume. So that might come in handy. For example, if you're given a density and a volume, you can solve for the mass of a product or reactant. So now that we've had a general introduction to stoichiometry, let's see how this applies to a basic example. So this is just going over the general steps we just took a look at. It's starting with, we find the number of moles of the reactant. Then we use the stoichiometric coefficients in a balanced chemical reaction to find the moles of whatever unknown it is we're asking for. Usually it'll be a product. And then they might be wanting some other information on that product, like what is its mass, what is its pressure, whatever that is. We'll need its moles in order to calculate those things. So remember, the central unit is moles. So let's take a look at it at an easier example. So here we're told that we have 2.6 grams of sodium metal reacting with water to form sodium hydroxide and hydrogen, according to the unbalanced reaction below. Then it says, once the reaction is complete, how many grams of sodium hydroxide are formed? So my tip here is that on your exam, your prof will not specify if an equation is balanced or unbalanced. They're not going to tell you, you know, this is an unbalanced reaction. So anytime you see a chemical reaction on your exam or even in your homework, I want you guys to get into the habit of checking if it's balanced. So double check if it's balanced. If not, you have to balance it because we need to take into consideration the stoichiometric coefficients. And if we don't balance it, we're going to get the wrong answers for these stoichiometry problems. Okay, so the first thing is always to balance it. So why don't we balance this one? On the left, we have one sodium atom. On the right, we also have one sodium atom. So perfect. On the left, we have one oxygen. On the right, we also have one oxygen atom. Great. On the left, we have two hydrogen atoms. And on the right, we have three hydrogen atoms. And on the right, I see that there is one hydrogen on its own. So that's going to make the number of hydrogens on the right side be an odd number, which we don't want. So we're going to want to multiply this by 2 to make an even number. So now we have two sodium atoms. So I'm just going to change this to a 2 as well. We have two oxygen atoms. So I have to change this to a 2 as well. And now let's check if the hydrogens are balanced. So on the left side, we have 4 hydrogens. And on the right side, we have 2 plus 2, which is 4. So perfect. We now have a balanced reaction. So now let's write in what we're being given here. So we have the mass is 2.6 grams for sodium. And we're asked how many grams of sodium hydroxide are formed. So what we're going to want to do here is, like we said, we're always going to want to figure out moles of what we can. So I can see that we can find the moles of sodium using this equation. N is equal to little m over big M. Okay, once I find the moles, using the stoichiometric coefficients, the second thing I'm going to do is find the moles of sodium hydroxide. And then finally, once I have the moles of sodium hydroxide, I'll be able to find the mass. Again, using this equation, N is equal to little m over big M. We would rearrange that to solve for mass, where we take the moles of sodium hydroxide and multiply by its molar mass. Okay, so let's go ahead and see how this would be done. So the first thing, like we said, we had to balance this reaction. Nice, we already did that. The second thing, we were just told that we had a mass of 2.6 grams here. So we said we wanted to first figure out the moles of sodium. So to figure out the moles of sodium, we use the equation M over big M. Sometimes other profs will write MW to represent molecular weight, but it means the same thing as molar mass. And when we do that for sodium, we find that we'll get 0.113 moles. Great. Now that we have moles of sodium, we'll want to use the stoichiometric coefficients here and here to figure out moles of sodium hydroxide. So just by looking at it, we might be able to just figure out how many moles there are of sodium hydroxide. So I see that for every 2 moles of sodium, I'm going to get 2 moles of sodium hydroxide. So it's a 1-to-1 ratio. So it's actually going to be the same number of moles that we'll get for sodium hydroxide. But I want to show you guys the calculation method because for more complicated problems, we'll definitely want to be very familiar with this. So let's go through that. How would I figure out moles of sodium hydroxide using a calculation method where we're crossing out units? So I have the moles of sodium, which is 0.113 moles, and I'm going to multiply by the coefficient. So on the bottom, I want there to be the coefficient of sodium so that they cancel out. So you're pretty much doing the moles of sodium. And here there are 2 moles of sodium. And then on the top, we're doing the moles of sodium hydroxide according to the balanced chemical equations coefficient, which is also 2. So you end up doing 0.113 times 2 over 2, which gives you 0.113. So we'll definitely be using this method when we solve problems. Finally, since we now have the moles of sodium hydroxide, we can go ahead and solve for its mass. So we said we're going to use this same equation. We'll rearrange to solve for the mass. We're going to take the moles of sodium hydroxide and multiply by its molecular weight. So here we have its moles, and then we got its molecular weight from the periodic table, and you'll end up getting a mass of 4.5 grams.
Want more bite-sized lessons? Check out the Wise free trial at wiseprep.com. Oh, and subscribe to our YouTube channel while you're here.